Hello, this is Russell Davies with The Art of Artists, exploring the sources of the creative life, which, in the case of some fortunate folk, continues hectically into what used to be thought of as comfortable old age. Not that Barry Cryer is ever uncomfortable, as his long tenure on I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue has shown. Wherever humour goes, Barry goes smoothly with it, and he's probably been there before. Nobody has more friends in more show business generations than Barry, or observes his fellow professionals more shrewdly, which is why we're so used to seeing him in the role of obituarist when some star has passed from the great showbiz firmament. But we don't normally hear Barry talk much about himself. Even as an old mate of his, as so many are, I'm unclear about many bits of his rollicking past. And here's an extraordinary example of something I'd never come across before. Barry the rock star, singing, as seriously as it can be sung, that great anthem of the late 50s, The Purple People Eater.
Well, I saw the thing coming out of the sky. It had one long horn, one big eye. I commenced to shake it and I said, hooey. It looks like a purple people eater to me. It was a one-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater. Sure looks strange to me.
One eye.
Well, he came down to earth and he lit in a tree. I said, Mr. Purple People Eater, don't eat me. I heard him say in a voice so gruff,
I'm gonna eat you cause you're too tough.
It was a one-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater.
One-eyed,
one-horned, flying purple people eater. What a sight to see.
One-horned.
I said, Mr. Purple People Eater, what's your line? He said, eating purple people and it sure is fine. But that's not the reason that I came to land.
I wanna get a job in a rock and roll band.
Well, bless my soul, rock and roll, fly purple people eater. Pigeon-toed, undercoat, fly purple people eater. Friendly little people eater, what a sight to see. From the tree and he laid on the ground, started to rock, really rocking around. It was a crazy ditty with a swinging tune. Oh yeah, bless my soul, rock and roll, flying purple people eater. Pigeon toed undergrowth, flying purple people eater. He wears short shorts,
flying purple people eater.
What a sight to see. Oh, well, he went on his way and then why do you know, I saw him last night on a TV show, a blowing it out.
On the Fontana label, which is a historical reference in itself, that was Barry Cryer in his all-out rocker phase and heading for the top of the charts in Finland. Remarkable. Barry, even before I welcome you, and welcome, by the way, I must reassure the listeners that none of that was a joke. That was your start as a pop star, and in some ways a promising one.
Number one in Finland?
Yes.
It was written by Sheb Woolley, the singer and actor. He was one of the baddies who was going to try and kill Gary Cooper in High Noon.
Ah.
And it was a sort of E.T., extraterrestrial. Oh, dear. And it was quite a hit in America, a bit of a hit here. But I think for contractual reasons or something, they didn't issue his record in Scandinavia.
Right.
So they pushed out my little English cover version, and I get this phone call. You're number one in Finland. It lasted 3 weeks, number one. I'm so proud of that.
Yeah.
What a line in your CV, number one in Finland.
It was the angry young man period, and you do sound rather cross in that.
I know, that's right.
Yeah. A chance to record is what we all wanted in those days.
Oh, yes.
1958. How did one actually get to have that chance?
Well, the thing was, Frankie Vaughan, we never met in Leeds,
yeah,
but we met later in London, and he became a mentor and a great friend, and he was big recording star in those days. He got me an audition with Fontana Records and turned up with me at my audition. And looking back, I think they're going, oh, boy, oh, let's humour Frank. We'll give this, give this, you know, three records and an option, which dropped with a resounding thud.
Well, it's a valuable piece of evidence as to your state of mind at the time, I think, because although you've written autobiographies and everybody knows you, notoriously, we all know you for talking about other people.
Yes.
And if anyone wants an informed opinion about performer X or Y, not always at obituary time, but often then, sad to say, then you're the go-to man.
I know, I'm the talking head.
Yeah.
I met the great Doddy recently. I hadn't seen him for several years, and he pointed at me and said, "Young man, you're always on television talking about dead people." Yes, you're a survivor, I suppose, and they pull you out and... Yeah.
And this is all to do with sociability, though, it really, isn't it? I mean, you love having chums, and many of the chums have been fellow writers and performers.
I'm terminally gregarious, yes.
Mm.
I'm a peopleaholic.
Yes.
I need the noise and the people, yeah.
Amateur psychology now, is it all making up for something? Because you mentioned your childhood being in some ways quite solitary. Even though you weren't brought up on a remote farm in Argyll anything, you were in Leeds.
My dad died when I was five.
Yeah.
And my brother John was away in the Merchant Navy, so it was me and my mother growing up there.
Right.
And I was talking to a driver the other day. They got me a car to go to a gig or whatever, and we were talking about life, and he said, "You've got children?" I said, "Yeah, we've got four." He said, "I've got five." And we compared notes. He said, "My dad died when I was very young." I said, "So did mine. We're bonding here." And he said something, Russell, that I never forgot. He said, "We lost our father. Maybe that's why we wanted to be one."
Yeah.
It's strange. It might be a compensation factor. Yeah. I've got this family and this huge clan, in-laws and outlaws and everything, and I just love it.
Yeah. You lived through the wartime, of course, and normally the story of that is evacuation, but it was the other way around with you.
The other way around.
Somebody was billeted on you.
Yes, and Leeds was very lucky. The comedy legend in Leeds was there was only two big hits, bomb-wise, in Leeds. The art gallery and a pub. The Golden Cock. All human life is there.
Yeah.
Yeah, we met evacuees, and a friend of mine, a boy we affectionately dubbed Cockney, you know, he was our mate, and we were absolutely fascinated what's going on here. And we had young soldiers billeted with us as well at time to time. Fascinating time.
Yes, it must have been. Leeds University you went to.
Yes.
And there was review, R-E-V-U-E, to perform.
Yes, spelled correctly.
Even know how to spell it these days. But it was the student art form of the time, wasn't it? Sketches,
yep.
Songs, parodies, and the chance to be both good and bad within the space of a few minutes.
Oh, yes, yeah. Yes. Yeah. And you were prancing about, showing off in front of big audiences of friends and family, you know, for charity and everything. And I hope I didn't get too carried away. But, you know, you began to think you were quite good.
Yeah, but and your first experience of professional theatre grew out of that review time.
Yes, indeed. It was the City Varieties where they subsequently did the good old days of TV and everything. And Stanley and Michael, the Joseph brothers who ran the theatre, they offered me a week's work. And I always say, and I mean this in a warm way, contradictorily, it was like a cold shower because you'd been jumping about thinking you were something in the student show. But this was the real world. You were doing about 12 minutes in a strip show. There were strippers and an older comic who was marvellous to me. But that was an education in 1 week. You learned to die with dignity.
It was a kind of catch-22, wasn't it, in those days? Because you had to have a card to work in the theatre, but you couldn't get a card without working
unless you'd
in
been
the theatre.
Yes,
yes, so
I know.
It was a circular process. Yeah. So you had to cheat somewhere.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you also sang with bands. We associate you now with singing one song to the tune of another, but song and tune were in alignment in those days, I gather.
Yes.
Mm.
And that's when I met the great Littleton, the great Humph. I was singing outside Leeds Town Hall with the University Jazz Band.
Yeah, all right.
And the man was in town. I mean, he was a star on the name then, Bad Penny Blues. And he came over to me and he said, "Hello, Humphrey Littleton." I said, "Oh." I said, "Hello, Barakat." "Yes, yes. Just heard you singing with the band." "That was quite something." I said, "Oh, thank you very much. You're quite loud." We were friends ever afterwards. "You're quite loud."
Yeah.
And an accolade.
You favoured sort of black American jazz and what became soul later on, didn't
Here
you?
Here we go again. You know, where did I come from? I always had an affinity with rock and roll and gospel and blues. And
yes.
And to this day I have it. with my friend Ronnie Golden. We do gigs together, and we write all the songs, no covers, and it's all rock and roll, gospel, blues and jokes.
Yes. Well, I remember you saying when Unchained Melody came out, you wanted the Al Hibbler version, the black version.
The original.
And not Jimmy Young.
Yes.
Yes, even though that was the
And the Righteous Brothers, didn't they do it as well? Could be wrong there.
Yes, I suppose that was a bit later. But
no, yeah. Al Hibbler, the original, yes.
Yeah. And that left you with a ready-made signature tune, that band experience, which you've performed hundreds of times since, because wherever there's a band, they're at liberty to call upon you to sing Dr. Jazz.
It's right? My repertoire of one, yes.
Right. Well, we've got to hear that.
Oh.
So here is Dr. Jazz from close to its origins. It was written by King Oliver, but his version didn't have a vocal on it, so there's no
point.
Oh,
right.
The famous pioneering version from 1926, but brilliantly recorded for that era, or any era, I think, was by Jelly Roll Morton and his Red Hot Peppers.
Oh.
So I think we should hear that. Jelly Roll Morton's Red Hot Peppers with exuberant vocal in the style of Barry Cryer, of course, by Mr. Jelly Roll himself. And that was recorded by a genius, don't know who it was, a genius of the early electrical arts anyway, in the Webster Hotel in Chicago, 1926. Meanwhile in Leeds, you left there to go on theatrical tour of what were known as the Number Threes.
Yes.
Which sounds, well, what sounds happened, a bit lavatorial.
Blew eyes got to university and blew it. I'm BAing it failed of Leeds University. I lasted a year.
Uh-huh. Did you resign or did they
No, they resigned me. I could have crawled back in with two retakes, I think, but my first year results were not good because I was too interested in girls and being in the bar.
Yes.
By the way, my academic CV is one line. BA England failed, Honorary Doctor of Arts. Leeds Met made me an Honorary Doctor of Arts last year, so I'm very proud of my one-line CV.
It's a pleasing symmetry.
But another mentor was David Nixon, the magician, who came to do pantomime. And, of course, I was in my enforced gap year. I was Johnny Gunn, the stage manager at the Empire Theatre, who remembered me from the student show, offered me work as a stagehand. And Leo Lyon, I'm not making this up, the manager of the Empire Theatre.
Really?
I was known as the Toff to the lads because I'd been at Leeds University. Yeah. And he thought he could look after Mr. Nixon. So I was his dresser assistant, not on stage, and we became friends, David Nixon. He said, you should get down to London. And he was a mentor. I never forgot him. He said, get down there. And subsequently, I did touring shows. Not in these shows, but shows with titles like Fanny Get Your Fun and We've Nothing On Tonight. Yes. I think you've got the picture.
Yeah, I think. Strip, Strip, Hooray, I remember.
All those, yes. I was very happy.
Yes.
Very happy.
David Nixon, of course, was famous not only for magic, but he was on What's My Line. He was
indeed.
Panelist on the most popular show on TV.
And he was, he was the impetus. Said, get down to London, gave me his phone number, and I had a 17-day rail return ticket. You look back, what was that? I was going to conquer London in 17 days, you know.
What was your plan? I mean, did you
I don't know. He got me auditions. He took me to his shows, introduced me to people.
Yeah.
And I can't remember how it happened. I got an audition at the Windmill. Six shows a day, 6 days a week, 36 shows. And they used to do conveyor belt auditions in the morning. Wheel them on, wheel them off. And I auditioned at 10:30, and I told some jokes, and I sang a song, and then this voice, it was a great man, Vivian Van Damme, the boss,
yes,
known to us all as VD, and do you know any more jokes? So I told some more jokes. Do you know another song? Well, I haven't got the dots, the music. Oh, Ronnie will busk. Ronnie Bridges, the pianist, who became a friend, and I sang another song. Thank you. I thought, well, that's it, really. And a man came on the stage, John Law, also became a friend, and said, dressing room 12A. I said, sorry, what are you talking about? He said, you've got the job. I was on the stage at 12:30 when I'd auditioned at 10:30, in a state of shock. And the old man had me in his office between the fish tank and the desk, between every show that day. Don't like that joke. That joke's very good. You tell it too early. Here's another one you could do. Change my act in one day.
Yeah.
And I rang my mother and said, I'm a windmill comedian. She had no idea what I was talking about. Serendipity or what? It's amazing.
Yes, yes. So he was quite a keen editor of comic routines, Vivian.
Well, he loved comedians.
Yes.
But he knew his public came to see the strippers.
Yes.
So he could indulge, bless his heart, comedians, Harry Seacombe and Peter Sellers, Eric and Jimmy Edwards, they all worked there.
Yes, yes. Now, the auditions, you had to resume when that came to an end, and it resulted in Espresso Bongo, which is now a cult name, partly because you have to explain to people why it isn't Espresso.
Because we always said Espresso in those days.
Yeah, but it was a satirical British musical on the subject of the social scene at the time.
Loosely based on Tommy Steele, really.
Uh-huh.
And Tommy's future wife, Annie, was in it at one point.
Yeah.
Yes, and the great Paul Scofield, who'd never done a musical, and we were in awe of him, which soon evaporated because he was so open and funny.
Yeah.
We lost the awe. I mean that as a compliment to him.
Mm.
Don't say hello, then. That was his catchphrase. Dressing room door always open. Don't say hello, then. And he loved it. And Bert Rhodes, the MD, said, Paul's amazing. He's got almost perfect pitch as a singer. He's never done a musical. He's a great actor, but his timing's a bit off now and again, and he'll skip a couple of bars. And Bert would signal the band, who would go quiet, and the pianist would keep playing, let's find out where Paul is in this song. Oh, he's a lovely man.
Yeah.
My audition for Espresso Bongo, I was in a bed sit in North Finchley, And I thought, oh, boy, what am I going to do? What am I going to sing? So I'd sat down and wrote a song in my bedsit called Espresso Bongo. Kid from a back street with a crazy beat and all this rubbish. And there was a man, I'm speaking carefully now, called Doc Hunt, who ran Musical Instrument Place. And he was amused by this young oik saying, could I hire some bongos? How long do you want them for? I said, a couple of hours. And he charged me a couple of quid or pounds or something. Couldn't play them, I just hammered them. And I went on, did a reading, and then hammered my bongos and sang this awful song. Dead silence, and Monty Norman came on the stage and said, where do you get that song? I said, I wrote it last night in my bed sit. He said, thank God. They thought there was already a song called Espresso Bongo and they were going to get sued or something.
Oh, dear.
So I think I got that job through sheer cheek.
Yes. And Monty, of course, wrote the James Bond theme.
That's yes, indeed.
They claimed to fame. Yes, indeed. There were a lot of London faces in it, weren't there? I mean, people like George Tovey, who were always in Cockney.
Yes, Millicent Martin.
Yes, yes.
We opened in Newcastle on the tour. And there was a minimalist set, and Millicent Martin's flat was a flat scenery held up by weights. And Paul would enter through the door and kick the door shut behind him.
Yeah.
And this is in Newcastle on the first night. He came to the door, kicked the door shut, and the whole thing fell down, the scenery.
Yeah.
And you could see the back wall of the theatre, dust rising, and he pulled Millie Martin out of the way. Stunned silence in the audience, really embarrassing moment. And Paul just turned and looked and turned back and said, mice. Oh, God, he's funny, man.
Yeah. Well, we must hear a song from that. It's a toss-up, really, isn't it, between the solo that he did, Paul Scofield, or, and I know there's a story attached to this, so I rather favour, The Shrine on the Second Floor.
Oh.
Now, we should keep the story till after we've heard it.
Because, yes, let's do that.
Yes, because for now, suffice it to say that the audience listened to this song in respectful silence. To say the least, here it is, The Shrine on the Second Floor.
I was born in the heart of a city, in a room that I'll always adore. Though it's not much to see, it's like heaven to me, that shrine on the second floor. There's a beautiful gray-haired Madonna who once taught me what life had in store. And I lift up my eyes to that saint in disguise, in the shrine on the second floor. Whenever my troubles seem too much to bear, I look for the answer, and then I kneel down and see that light shining up there, and everything turns out right again. When I'm old and I find that I'm lonely, I'll return to my heaven once more. I'll remember the face of that lady of grace in the shrine on the second floor. When I'm old and I find that I'm lonely, I'll return to my heaven once more. I'll remember
Gray grey-haired Madonna, oh dear, from Espresso Bongo, James Kenny and the Shrine on the second floor, and you take the story from there.
Well, Barry, it was the end of the first act. This was Bongo Herbert, the hero, and there was stained glass windows, and we were all choristers in surplices and everything behind him. And Jimmy Kenny sang this very funnily written, satirical, religioso song. But the audience took it absolutely seriously. Respectful silence, enormous applause, and the joke was misfiring. And it was Paul Scofield's idea. He suggested it, and they said, oh, try it tonight, Paul. And Jimmy finished this impassioned song, and before the audience could applaud, Paul Scofield walked on the stage and said, that was lovely, wasn't it? And that did it. That triggered it. The audience went, oh, it wasn't meant to be serious.
Well, you were doing all kinds of other bits and pieces, which I'm afraid we have probably haven't got time to go through them all, but you wrote with Ted Dix, didn't you?
Who
was half the Miles Rudge Ted Dix partnership that wrote all the Bernard Cribbins hits.
Yes, indeed.
Yeah. And Jimmy Logan, you wrote some stuff for. Was that your first TV?
I'm friend of the family. Honorary Scott, really. Two of the first people I wrote for on television were Jimmy Logan and Stanley Baxter.
Yes. But the continuous thing that happened, the steady job, as it were, turned out to be the nightclub writing and appearing with Danny LaRue and his crew in Mayfair. Winston's and then Danny LaRue's own club.
Yeah.
Yeah. Amazing hours. Curtain up at about
1:15.
In the morning.
1:15 a.m. Yes.
Goodness me, yeah. And Danny wasn't all that scrupulous about learning lines, was he? You know.
He was.
Isn't that frustrating when you've, as the writer, have put a lot of care into
it? You got used to it, and we're all a gang, and Ronnie Corbett, bless his heart, was in the show.
Yeah.
And Tony Palmer, the female Tony Palmer, old friend, was
with
in the show.
Yeah.
Danny, as you alluded to this, was more concerned in rehearsals with the costumes and the wigs and the frocks, as he called them.
Right.
And was a bit shaky on the lines when the show opened. But we would all prompt him. We'd be standing there. Ronnie Corbett showed me bruises on his arm once. Danny would grip your arm in a vice when he tried and couldn't remember the next line. And we got used to that. That was a signal. Prompt me back in.
And it was at Danny's, was it, that Frost came round and all that began? David Frost.
Who was massive at the time, Frosty, and he invited me and Ronnie Corbett for a drink. Maybe that was the reason he came, but, you know, you look back at these incidents in life, you know. And we had a drink with David Frost, and as a result, Ronnie went into the Frost Report, the series, and I became a Frost writer. And if you were a Frost writer in those days, you could have been rubbish. But, oh, no, that was it. Doors were open everywhere for you if you were a Frost writer.
Yeah.
But I always say if you get a lucky break and the door opens, once you go through, people go, get on with it, justify the lucky break, you know.
Yeah.
My wife gets very annoyed because I say I've been dogged by good luck all my life, and she says, that's false modesty. I say, no, it's the truth. The meetings with people, you know.
Yes.
Just these moments when you meet somebody or something happens and it changes your life, actually.
Talking of which, your wife herself you met about that time.
Met the very same day I met Ronnie Corbett.
Really?
At a nightclub rehearsal. Mm-hmm. I met my darling very same day, and I tossed a coin and married her.
And
I laughed about it. Yeah, that's nothing personal, Ron.
How many years ago is that now?
That's quite recent. That was 1961, I think.
Mm-hmm. Gosh, well done. Out of the Frost, of course, with Frost came a package of other people, and all the Pythons, really, before they were the Pythons.
Well, there's a whole gang of us. I met all the Python before they were Python, as you said, and goodies, and great veterans like Keith Waterhouse, and, you know, we're also writing. And
your pet Python became Graham Chapman in the end. I mean, you did a lot of writing.
Well, Frosty, the practising catalyst, brilliant with people. Graham Chapman and I become friends, but Graham always wrote with John Cleese in those days. Frosty mooted the idea of me and Graham writing together. We'd never thought of that. And in conjunction with Eric Idle, who had to leave after the first series, we wrote Ronnie Corbett's first sitcom, No That's Me Over Here, title that baffled everybody. But Frosty put Graham Chapman and I together, and we finished up writing over 50 shows together. He was amazing, like, great entrepreneur, the man. He just, people man, you know.
Yes. And I suppose you must have had the same cast of mind about jokes, which is an interesting subject to me, because the particular cast of mind needed to manage and create jokes. I mean, I haven't got it. I mean, I've written comedy scripts. My mind will not retain jokes. I simply don't remember them, and not even the general outline of them, let alone the particular phraseology that you need to make a joke work, you know, yeah. The precise words, which is great for you, because if by any chance you tell me one that you've told me before, it's all news to me.
No, the tools of the trade. My memory in real life is abysmal. I get rebuked by my wife and everything. I forget family birthdays. I've got, short-term memory loss. I was just going to do something just now. What was that? I've forgotten. But the jokes are in my head. I don't have any floppy disks or any files. You just hope something pops out of your head that's relevant in terms of jokes.
But it always does in your case, which is remarkable.
Yeah.
Yes. Who was difficult to write for? I think you've mentioned Tommy Cooper was.
Well, working with him was a great pleasure, but he wasn't a great reader. He wasn't dyslexic, but he didn't like reading. He'd rather get a rough idea of the sketch or something.
Yeah.
I mean, the sketch wasn't his natural territory. He was used to being stand-up on his own.
Yeah.
But once you got him on the floor rehearsing a sketch, he was brilliant. But reading it, no. And I, first time I wrote for him, I noticed he repeated himself a lot. Good evening, good evening. So we sat down, all of us, and I'd written a little bit for him, 2 or 3 minute bit, and they pressed the stopwatch, and Tom looked at it and went, good evening, good evening, what's this? So they stopped the stopwatch, and he said, what's this, Barry? I said, well, I've noticed you say things twice, so I put good evening, comma, good evening, full stop. You put it once, I'll say it twice, and you get the best of the bargain. Never knew what that meant.
No.
But you give him an idea, jotted on a bit of paper. That was what was writing for Tommy Cooper.
Yeah.
Dick Hills and I wrote for Tom on ITV, and we were just laughing, saying we won't even write this sketch. We just wrote ventriloquist on cruise liner, rough sea. And that was it. They made a marvellous tilting set. Tommy was the ventriloquist sliding up and down on this deck, the doll making remarks and the doll's head falling off. A porthole would open now and again, and somebody would throw a bucket of water over Tom. And it was sheer joy, and it was a few words on a bit of paper. That's what you did with Tommy.
Yes. Is it true that Frankie Howard wanted all those oohs and ahs and...
He played games. If you put the ooh no, Mrs. Now then, ooh no, don't take a vote on it, he'd say, I do those. And if you didn't put them in, he'd say, where are they?
I see.
He always liked wrong-footing writers.
Yeah, yeah. With Kenny Everett, of course, another favourite collaborator.
Oh, yeah.
There was the famous catchphrase, all in the best possible taste, which didn't disguise that taste was an issue. I mean, there were things that you would have liked to have changed, I think.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Like Sid Snot, you never liked the name.
Oh, I never liked
and
the
name. And you got outvoted with that and so on. And you could see certain things coming, like the Tory conference stuff disaster.
When he was a one-off.
You told him not to be there and he
yes, he was invited by Michael Winner.
Yeah.
Come and have a laugh. And I was with him on the Friday. We were filming something. This is the hindsight saga.
Yeah, yeah.
I said, oh, are you sure? Don't go. What do you mean, bar? He always called me bar, which is where he usually found me, I suppose. I said, and knowing you, something will happen. What a prophecy that was.
Yeah.
Took his big polystyrene hands, young conservatives, waved his polystyrene hands, let's bomb Russia! Let's kick Michael Foot's stick away! Much mirth. The journalists knew what he was doing, but they were cynical, so they took it just as...
Yes.
Daily Mirror had a big front page with him as Jekyll and Hyde, his face divided into two halves, bubbly Ken and an ugly Ken, the idiot face of conservatism.
Yeah.
And he said, oh, it's tomorrow's fish and chips. I said, it's going to haunt you, Ev. And I was with him a lot when he was interviewed subsequently, and every interviewer brought that up.
Yes.
What was all that let's bomb Russia? Mm-hmm. And he gave me a funny look, thinking, here we go again.
Yeah. Now, much easier to deal with, surely, because this was a great chum, was Willie Rushton. Was it with Willie that you started your personal tradition of going up to Edinburgh with two-man shows? Was his the first?
No, it was with Colin Sell, my friend to this day, who does the radio.
Oh, yeah.
Sorry, I haven't a clue. Colin and I did it, way back, early 90s. But subsequently, Willie and I did.
Yeah.
Because Willie and I had started doing theatre show called Two Old Farts in the Night.
Right.
Title was Willie's idea, so we can't get done under the Trade Descriptions Act.
Yeah.
And we played Edinburgh, yeah.
Yeah. He was a funny man with a beard, and some folks say there's no such thing. But you had a beard for a time.
Oh, dear heaven, yes, old clips of me with a beard. Oh, dear.
Mm.
We were sponsored by Taylor's Port. You couldn't make it up, but when we played Edinburgh for the first time, Willie and I, and Willie would beam at the audience and announce our sponsor. They all got a glass of port on the way in, which put the audience in quite a good mood.
Very nice.
And Willie would beam at the audience and say, "Thank you, Taylor's Port." An amazing drink. Combination of aphrodisiac and tranquilizer. If you don't get what you're after, it doesn't bother you.
Let's hear him on record, because we don't often get this chance. But he did record a song on the subject of Private Eye's favourite suburb or sub-suburb, Neasden. Now, did you have anything to do with the writing of this? Because it's it's credited to Private Eye.
It was part of a Private Eye album when they used to give away these little floppy discs with the magazine.
That's right, yes. And I think the musical accompaniment, if that can be called by that name, is by the Alberts. Could that be right? I think it's the
album. Sounds right.
Yeah. Anyway, this is Neasden.
I've been as far as Orpington, Tufnell Park and Golders Green, seen the northern lights of Alsden and visited East Sheen. I've travelled out to Ongar on the dear old Central Line. I even went to Ruislip in 1949. I've been far south as Tooting Beck, where sheep may safely graze. And I sometimes think it's hard to say where I'd like to end my days. But then I shout, "Oh, Arthur, what a Burke you are. There's a little place you love just off the North Circular. They call it Neasden. You won't be sorry that you breezed in. The traffic lights and yellow lines, the illuminated signs all say welcome to the borough that everybody's pleased in. He's done. Where the birds sing in the trees, done. You can hear the blackbirds coo, so why not take the Bakerloo? It'll work out that much cheaper if you buy a seas done. He's done. Where the rissoles are deep freeze, done. Where there's bingo and boutiques and the wimpies last for weeks and very tasty too with a slice of cheese and Neasden. You could want a better reason. Ah, you will not fail to thrill when you hear at Dolly's Hill that the next stop on the line is the place that I call mine. Is it Sodom or Gomorrah? No, it's God's own borough, Neasden. Neasden. Neasden.
Willie Rushton being only marginally rude, though Neasden, I think, has found it hard to recover from the battering it got from the Eye in those days. Willie, of course, wasn't a regional figure. He was a generically posh. But you grew up in a world where northern and southern humour were still very different and distinct. Morecambe and Wise, for example, were national heroes, and you helped them be that, but they were still very northern in flavour.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've often thought that as individuals, they were different in the way that Lancashire and Yorkshire are still different.
Yes.
You know, Lancashire is more goofy and subversive.
But you can't define it. Look at the number of comedians who came out of Liverpool,
yeah.
One city.
Yeah.
I think it's something to do with it being a port and a blend of people and everything.
Yeah. When you from the north met great southern comics like Max Miller, for example, which you did you feel that they were a different animal?
Yes, but you admired them. My mother took me to see Max Miller at Leeds Empire Theatre when I was quite young. He was making one of his rare forays
into
up
the
north.
Yeah.
And I never forgot that. My mother sat there twinkling like mad. This was the naughty boy, this naughty comedian. It fascinated me looking back that my mother was a Max Miller fan, this respectable middle-class lady, you know, and everything. And that was the first time I saw him. And I didn't get a lot of the stuff. I was very young, but charisma of that man, his presence on the stage, oh, boy.
Yeah, yes. Let's go back to jokes, material, and the disputes that arise over that, because there have been feuds, there still are, between comics over so-called stolen gags and all that. Is that common to all generations? Do they all do that?
Well, of course, now, some brilliant people around now, it's observational and life and how life's... They don't tell jokes, per se, in their act now. Jokes as jokes. Very few of them do.
Yeah.
A young stand-up said to me one year in Edinburgh, "You tell jokes?" Couldn't believe it. Every generation likes jokes before and after the show, after the gig, but they don't... I'm generalising.
Yeah.
The current breed of performers don't tell jokes, so it doesn't happen. But in the old days... And jokes are public domain. You didn't pinch material that somebody had obviously written for themselves.
Yeah.
But jokes are jokes, you know.
Yeah.
People to this day say to me, "I told one of your jokes last night." I say, "They're not mine. I only leased them." You're quite entitled to tell that joke. I heard it somewhere.
Is it possible, in your experience, to be amused by a comedian whom you don't actually like as an individual?
What a good question, he said, patronising. No, it hasn't really happened. There are no names, no patrol. I think one or two comedians... Yes, I think I was prejudiced from the start. I'm not proud of that. One or two comedians I didn't like much as people. I couldn't find it in myself to laugh when they did their act, and they were rather good. So, no, I never thought about it quite like that. It did influence me when I was watching them.
Mm-hmm. Going back to Willie Rushton, of course, he's a big part of the endless history of I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, known as Clue from now on. How long is it now, that history?
1972, 44 years now.
Yeah.
We can't
believe
it.
Yeah. And before it settled down into a permanent pattern, you were one of the chairmen with Humphrey Littleton.
Well, he was the chairman, but he couldn't do a couple of recording dates, so... I've got a yellowing old cutting from the Radio Times, this creature with the glasses and the black hair. I was chairman a couple of programmes, but Willie and I weren't in the original as panellists because it was a spin-off from I'm Sorry, I'll Read That Again. So it was Graham Garden, Bill Oddie, Joe Kendall, John Cleese and all that. And they fell by the wayside. They didn't like it. They'd wanted a script, you know, and... It wasn't regarded as a good proposition when it started. I think it was Tony Whitby, a man at the BBC, who fought for it. But they imported me and Willie Rushton in subsequently.
Because one or two left. I mean, John Cleese, I suppose.
Oh, John couldn't stand it.
Yeah,
he,
no.
He wanted a script.
Yeah. It's odd that such a tremendously popular programme has been actually controversial in more than one way. I mean, rude jokes, for one thing.
Oh, yes.
But as the great lamented Victoria Wood used to say, if it makes you laugh, then bad taste doesn't come into it.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, it's the double entendre, the endless playing with words, and Samantha, our lovely scorer, who is... the dominant figure in any situation. It certainly isn't patronising to Samantha.
Yeah.
I won't go into details here, but she is controlling the situation.
Yes, yes. You've been very, very lucky or clever in the choice of Jack D as chairman, I think.
Well, when Humph left us, the Great Lipton, we didn't do it for a year. We said, that's it, it's over.
Yeah.
And then the BBC wanted us back and all this went on. And we did six shows, two with Stephen Fry, who was... who'd done the show anyway as a panellist, but he was sort of a bit knowing as the chairman.
Yeah, yeah.
Rob Brydon, who was brilliant, he did it when Humph went in the hospital. And Jack D, and we sat in a room and went, it's got to be Jack D, detached, sarcastic, and he was very modest about it, like, you know, filling the shoes, I'll just do the job, because he venerated Humph.
Yes.
And, yes, if you're going to replace Humphrey Littleton, we did the Rose Theatre, Kingston in Surrey, and in the middle of a recording, a man in the audience said very loudly, "It's not the same without Humphrey Littleton, is it?" Terrible silence. And Jack said, "Ah, oh, dear Humph, I wonder where he is now. I envy him." Sheer style, isn't it,
yeah,
that?
Yeah, yeah. Of course, Humph in his pretense of being both above it all and off to the side of it, he was unforgettable. And those last editions, when his health was clearly failing, were very, very, very touching, I thought. But I think we should hear his music, because
he
was a friend of mine too. We made an album together, after all. And what I've got here is, of course, his great chart hit of 1956.
Oh.
Engineered by Joe Meek,
yes.
Who distorted all the ballads. balance, and Humph often said if he'd known what Meek was up to while he was on holiday, Humph, he'd have asked him not to put the record out. But then it hit the charts, and so he acquiesced. And it's the great Bad Penny Blues, of course. Humphrey Littleton's Bad Penny Blues turning up again. When so-called alternative comedy started up, I did a sort of documentary about it, wittily titled Is There a Racial Stereotype in My Soup? I met all the culprits, and it seemed at the time that the world was changing. Did it change for you? Did new rules cause you to adjust your way of doing things?
You went with the flow. Well, it was mainly writing more than performing during this era.
Yes.
I hope I wasn't. I never wrote alone. Oh, we weren't writing any racist, sexist stuff anyway. We didn't, not interested in all that.
Yeah.
No, it was interesting. These things come and go in cycles. You had Ben Elton fulminating about Margaret Thatcher and yes and yes. But there are certain constants. The Eric and Ernie's, the Frankie Howards and the Tommy Coopers and people just, they would express reservations. No, is our day over? But no. They were still there, constant, yes, through all this tide of change.
Yes. Of course, the new regime used to rail against stereotypes, but can we avoid them? Should we be ashamed of stereotypes?
No.
Collaboration of yours that I find hilarious is with Graham Garden. You know, you'll have had your tea.
Yes.
And a spin-off from Clue, which wouldn't have the life it has had without Scottish stereotypes that's based on
But
that.
We don't do... We don't do mean or anything. They're just two quaint old Scotsmen. You think, what are they about?
Yeah, yeah.
And Graham's half Scottish. I am a complete fraud. And we did a gig in Glasgow. I thought we'd get lynched here. No, it was a joy.
Mm. Your appetite for partnership has always, I mean, it's never diminished. And for, I think about 15 years you've been working now with Ronnie Golden.
Yeah.
He came out of the alternative movement, didn't he? He was, that's where
Fabulous Poodle, they had a band.
That's right, yeah.
In the States and everything. And we met one night at Hackney Empire and became friends. And I'd always harboured this desire to do rock and roll and gospel and blues and jokes and everything. And I was sitting with him one day. And I mentioned this. I said, would you be up for it? Yes, he said. great moments. That was it. Simply, yes, he said, and that was it.
It hasn't been a good year for the survival of the species, has it, in terms of performers, including comics. In fact, it's been a very bad year.
Oh, awful.
Yeah, yeah. And there are many I miss. One I wanted to recall especially, and that's Dick Vosborough.
Yes.
Wonderful, wonderful character.
Oh, God, he's a funny man. His passion was lyrics, writing lyrics more than... He was a great one-liner gag man, but brilliant lyricist. Ronnie Corbett did something way back, and he was doing a Cole Porter song. I can't remember which one. And there were only two verses or three, and for whatever reason, Ronnie wanted another verse. And Dick Vosborough wrote a pastiche Cole Porter verse. You couldn't tell the difference. It was brilliant.
Yes. You must go to all the showbiz funerals precisely for the reason that you know all these people. I mean, does it get oppressive? Is it?
Yeah, I need a season ticket for funerals and memorials. As we speak, I'm addressing my friend as Di. Did the listeners know you as Di? Russell Davies, ladies and gentlemen, known to us all as Di. Oh, Di, what an inappropriate moment.
I know, it's a sad name.
No, I mean, as we speak, I've been to 3 funerals in 10 days.
Oh.
Including our local vicar, Clive, and Paul Daniels and Ronnie Corbett, as we speak now. And we just lost Victoria Wood, as we sit here speaking. Terrible year. Yeah, but when you're in the frame, like I am, my age group, you think, well, there we go. Members of the club are leaving us, which is... If the memories are good and warm, it helps a bit, you know, it helps a bit if you, the memories make you laugh or smile and everything. But people do leave a gap, big gap. Ronnie Corbett, heavens above, I met him, as I said, in 1961 or maybe even 1960. That is a long time to be a friend.
Yeah. Comedians' funerals must be strange because people... In a way, are obliged to be funny, aren't they, in tribute to the deceased?
There's been a mixture of funerals through the years. Some, I think, have been over-reverent, and we could have done with a laugh, and others maybe too much the other way. But I quite understand if it's someone who did make us laugh, there's nothing wrong with laughing at a funeral. Nothing wrong with that at all.
We've arrived at our last piece of music, and this was one specified by you. So, and it takes you back to your old... Old days of the rock and roll. Jerry Lee Lewis. Now, why him? And his pumping piano.
Well, it's just the energy. I mean, I'm a great fan of the others, the Ray Charles and everything, and oh, and Little Richard. Yeah. But it's the sheer... Well, I respect your views on this, but it's the power of the piano playing and the energy of the man doing the songs. That's it. There's an indefinable thing that just makes you go, oh, yes, whenever I hear Jerry Lee.
Well, this takes us back even further back than the Purple People Eater, which is a long, long way. Barry, thank you very, very much. This has been a thrill, as I knew it would be.
Same time tomorrow?
Indeed. I look forward to it.
So do I.
This is What Did I Say?
Boogie woogie, how night long? All right. Yeah.
Barry Cryer's Last Choice, and there's still a rocker in there somewhere, you see. That was Jerry Lee Lewis's version of What Did I Say on Sun Records, where it's billed as Jerry Lee Lewis and his pumping piano. Who knows, if Barry had only been able to find a follow-up to the Purple People Eater, we might have been visiting him in his mansion in Memphis or Malibu. Instead, he continues to fulfil his unofficial but vital function as Britain's national curator of jokes. He overflows with jokes, quite literally. A phone call from Barry will eventually arrive at the words, "Here's one," and from that, almost anything may flow, broadcastable or otherwise. And then, at the end, he'll say, "I'll give you your day back now." He's a phenomenon, and grateful we should be for him. My thanks to him for dropping in, and also to my producer, Sara Cesardi. This was a Wise Buddha production for BBC Radio 2, online, on digital radio, and on 88 to 91 FM.